Yes, yes, yes. Welcome to BTM, to the Basketball Time Machine, the show about former NBA players, their careers, and simply NBA behind-the-scenes stories. In this episode, I got a very special guest from Croatia. He played for 6 years in the NBA, 7'3", Bruno Sundov. Welcome to the show. It's great to have you here, Bruno.
Thank you. Glad to be part of your show.
Nice to hear that, Bruno. I actually got a large list of questions, so let's get right into it. My first question would be, when did you realize that you actually have a shot playing in the NBA, especially as a European?
Well, when I was 18, I guess. I wasn't thinking too much about the NBA. I just wanted to become a basketball player. I grew a bit more than my average teammates. And obviously, I'm one of those international tournaments, NBA scouts saw me, and I was drafted 98 by Dallas.
All right, and did you have a favorite player, like an idol? I mean, especially from Europe playing the NBA, you had so many great players.
Of course, Dragan Petrovic was our idol from not only Croatia, from the whole region. So we all heard about the stories, and we was practicing how Dragan was working, how many hours Dragan was doing, so they kind of make us do the same. And I'm very glad they did this.
Yes, I see. There were so many great players that came from Croatia in the mid-90s. As I mentioned, Tony Kukoc, Dino Raja, yourself, Zentabek. So there was really a movement in Croatia back then.
It was great basketball in my city. Split 1 and 3 year leagues in a row, 89 and 90-91. And it was a big boom of basketball at the moment. And at the same time, I decided to play basketball, be one of them.
Okay, let's talk about your rookie season in the NBA. So you told me a funny story earlier, and correct me if I'm wrong, I understood that you said that you were the only player in NBA history who played high school basketball and in the NBA in the same season. Is that right? Because that's a crazy story.
Yes, circumstances was like this. It was a year, 98, when the lockout was happening. So many players look for the team to play for that particular time. I chose to go to prep school in Boston, Massachusetts, to learn the language, learn the culture, and same time play basketball. And then as soon as the lockout was over, Dallas called me to join them on the team. So the same year, I played high school.
Man, seriously, that's amazing. Being the only player in NBA history. Crazy. So let's talk more about your rookie season. So you were drafted by the Dallas Mavericks. And if I'm not mistaken, that was also Dirk Nowitzki's first season. And it was also Steve Nash's first season with the Mavericks. So you guys were probably the young guys on the team. How did that work out? And what kind of experience was that for you?
Yes, me and Dirk come from Europe. We come from different culture to the league. And kind of support each other, and Nash was there also in Canada, but he was studying and playing in the States, so he kind of welcomed us in the beginning to the culture. So we spent those 2 years pretty much on the roads and all.
Yes, you told me a funny story earlier about you, Steve Nash, and Dirk Nowitzki hanging out and not knowing what to do after practice, so you decided to go to a second practice, and at the end it didn't turn out too well for your teammates?
NBA is usually one practice per day. It's longer, from, let's say, from 10 to maybe 1 or 2 p.m. and that's it. But we come from different culture, from Europe. We used to practice twice per day, and we didn't know what to do in afternoons. So me, Dirk, and Steve go to the evening, 6, 7 p.m., and then, of course, the team had to give you one of the coaches to come with you. And then it was going like this for maybe a month. And coach decide, okay, if they can do it, rest of the guys, you have to do it also. So next thing you know, 7-8 guys was practicing twice per day. And then an American guy, like, we want free time. We want to do this. Why are you doing this to us? And that kind of become the rule to come at the second practice.
Wow, that made you probably really popular with your teammates.
Yeah, not really. And then coaches also, they have families that they used to be there for 4 or 5 hours, then the rest of the day they're free, especially on days off.
Yeah.
But no, we stick to the gym.
During that time period, you had some great teammates, some players that I like Gary Trent, and one player that I especially liked, AC Green, the Iron Man, the player with the most consecutive games in NBA history. And I remember when I watched NBA back then, for whatever reason, his streak ended. And you told me something about that, that it had something to do with you. So what was that all about?
It was a bad moment, I guess, for him. He stuck on my feet and strained the ankle very badly. But then come to miss a few games, so he really was mad at me. He's like, nobody could injure me before, now you coming, you rookie, you European, blah, blah, blah. You know. So he was really mad at me, but I guess he came back. I mean, he was healthy with the elbow to the chest. So I was out for a month. Of course, it was accident. That's what he said, but it's okay.
For sure. I remember you played with Michael Finlay during that period. I think he was an all-star. Yeah, tell me something about him. How was the relationship with Michael Finlay? And, of course, you played with Dennis the Worm Rutman. Tell me something about him. How did that work out for you and the team?
Mike Finlay was his first year when he made the all-star. So that become Dallas, they put him back on the map. All-star, great leader, great teammate on the court and off the court. You don't really need a coach with him on the team. Every team has pretty much one of the guys like this. But perfect example, great teammate, great hard worker. Dennis Rodman was a showman, as everybody knows. And that happened when Mark Cuban bought the team. And of course, he wanted to do some sensation. He wanted to put Dallas back on the news, back on the map, and he did this with Dallas. At the moment, Dallas wasn't the playoff team, we were losing many games, so it was marketing meal for Dallas, which pays off greatly because next 20 games left in the season, it was sold out. You know, and before, it wasn't even 50% of the gym were full. Bringing Dennis Rodman on a team, interest come back, and he achieved what he wanted to
achieve. But that was Mark Cuban's idea, right?
Yes, and it was his idea, with, of course, with the coach's blessing, but Rodman was out for a year or two, he didn't play, he wasn't much, but they say we need a boost, we need to put Dallas back on a map, and they take him out of retirement. Dennis stayed at his house, practice 2-3 times per day, just try to get back in shape. And happened what happened. What wasn't that great when he was playing, he was still making shows to sit on the half of the court. But everybody knew this. You know, Dallas needed to be back on the map again.
Yeah.
Okay, let's forward to the year 2000. You're coming from the young Dallas Mavericks to the veteran team of the Indiana Pacers, who had some great players like Reggie Miller, for example. So how was that transition, and was there just a cultural difference between the two teams? Because I imagine it had to be, completely different.
Dallas was not a competitive playoff team. Indiana, the year before, they just played NBA Finals with the Lakers. And that's winning mentality-wise, were totally different people in that locker room than Dallas. In Dallas, everybody used to losing. So I remember one quote later on, Isaiah Thomas said, "You know, winning is a habit. Unfortunately, it's losing." So, but then when you see this on a court, you realize this. You know, you lose a game, you lose another one, third one, it's okay, we're gonna lose again. But when you're winning, losing really hurts you. And Indiana was not used to losing. And then we have a successful season. I think we passed the first round in the playoffs. Of course, highlights of the team was Reggie Miller. He was everybody. I mean, your mother, your father, your coach, your assistant coach, your doctor. It's one team, one guy in a team who leading an example. How to need to be a leader, how need to be a captain. That's why he was high level for so long time.
Okay, well, one of your teammates was Jalen Rose, who came, I think he came back from the Chicago Bulls, had his best season. I think he averaged like 23 points a game. So how was that turning out? Was Jalen Rose a leader on the team, or was he in line behind Reggie Miller? Just give us some inside information about that.
Reggie was a leader. Jalen Rose wasn't his team. You know, and later on, he became right hand of Reggie, but you know, Reggie was a captain, and that's it. Everybody else, it's on a second kind of line. You know, and he was our truly leader on the court and off the court. I have one funny story with Reggie. He actually kicked coaching staff out of practice two or three times a year. Isaiah Thomas was coach, and we lost. Isaiah Thomas was coach, and I think we gave two or three bad games. He was losing on a losing streak, and coach wanted to refresh us. We come to the gym, and he wanted to give us off day. Say, guys, I think you guys need to clear your head. This usually works many times. And then Reggie said, no, we don't need to clear our heads, we need to work. You guys can go leave the gym, you prepare the next game, I'm going to lead the practice.
Wow.
So Isaiah was like, you heard the captain, coaches, please exit the gym. So we exit the gym, and Reggie was leading the practice for an hour and a half. He's like, okay, we're doing this, we need more movement on the defense, we need to do block shots. So he pretty much makes up the practice out of his head from the things what we're missing at that particular point. So it was one example of true leader.
Okay, but that's strange. Like that sounds like Reggie Miller would have been a great coach, and I'm wondering why he never pursued the coaching jobs.
I don't know. Maybe he will. But I think at the moment he's better with the mic.
Yeah, that's true.
In front of him, because coaching, it's a different animal.
That's
you
true.
Deal with not 15 personalities, you deal with 25, 30 personalities.
True.
On a daily basis, so this is a big, big step, I guess.
So in the year 2000, I think you only played like 11 games, but you started in four. So why did you play only a few games?
2000, I think you're missing. Because 2000, yeah, I'm not sure. I have to check.
Okay, but you didn't have any major injuries, for example?
Injuries, it was only, I guess, get time on the court, because it was a winning team and I was young, so I couldn't really get my role on.
Yes, that makes sense. I mean, you had a loaded team back then. The Indiana Pacers had great players like, Jared McKee, Terry Mills, Sam Perkins, and do you remember some of your former teammates from back then? Let me check.
Yes, Jermaine O'Neal, Jeff Foster was on 5, Austin Crusher on 4, Brad Miller came from Chicago as 5. So we have a good young teams, but when the year before, when you play playoffs, they used to winning everything, but then the team changed a year afterwards. So,
so how was it being coached by a true NBA legend like Isaiah Thomas? Was it a special experience?
Really, I'm still in contact with him. I ask him if I need some advice. He's always answered the phone. He's passing his experience as a player to the coaches. And if you ask any coach who played for Isaiah, they will tell you only positive things. Of course, on the news, Isaiah is criticized doing this, not a good leader, you know, whatever. But I was with him 3 years, 2 years in Indiana as a head coach, and he brought me back in New York, and he was a general manager. So he gave me contract in New York also. So all I can say with him, all the best, all the good things.
Really interesting that you're still in touch with him, that you had such a great experience. But hey, great. Let's move forward. So you played for the Boston Celtics during that time period.
Yeah, one of the greatest franchises in NBA history.
Bill Russell, Larry Bird, Kevin McHale, and so on and so on.
Was a special player with the most consecutive games in NBA history. And I remember when I watched NBA back then, for whatever reason, the streak ended.
All of the rafter.
That had something to do with you. So what was that all about?
Look up there, the numbers, you cannot take this one. And this is a list of the numbers than the team. So you were really in a short, you're in a short kind of street to what the number can you choose from. Boston experience was fan-wise, fanatics. I don't know how can you compare in Germany, in Croatia we have Zadar. Fans doesn't give you any credit. If you don't play well, New York is the same kind of. If you don't play well, they'll boo you off the court.
Because they take the game serious.
Take the game serious. They used to very high level players and any games before, so all they ask from you to give you 100%. You win or lose, it's okay. If you lose, if you play hard, they will applaud you after the game. But if you lose and play like shitty, I was a few times on a game in New York and Boston, your own fans to boo you off the court if you don't play well. So that experience was definitely great for me. And that year we played playoffs. I don't remember loudest plays ever during the playoff game when the fans go crazy. Let's say me and you sit next to each other. You cannot hear me speaking.
Wow.
How loud it gets in the gym. So this is Boston.
Yeah, one of your teammates was Vin Baker, who used to be an NBA All-Star only a few years earlier, but because of his alcohol problems, yeah, his career went down the drain, which is sad, but he's doing better now anyway. And one of your teammates was Bimbo Coles, who was also a great guy. You told me you're still in touch with him, or you used to hang with him. Yeah, tell me something about those two guys.
Vin, like you say, big problem with alcohol, and alcohol eat him up. He wasn't any of the Vin he used to be. I played with him in two teams. Boston and New York also. They bring him to New York, but same thing, alcohol problem, he couldn't stay sober. On the practices, he'd come drunk. So he wasn't really example to young guys.
Yeah.
But the other club problem with Vin, he has a huge contract, so they cannot just ignore him.
Yeah.
They have to take the best out of him, but that wasn't good for the team at all.
Okay.
Okay, but you had two other All-Stars on your team. You had Antoine Walker, young Antoine Walker, and a future Hall of Famer, Paul Pierce. So how was it working out with those two guys? How was practice? How competitive were they? What are the differences between the two of them? Yeah, just fill us in with that.
Paul Pierce will get closest to the Reggie Miller and Mike Finley kind of leaders on the team. We want to have those type of guys. Team, and he's definitely one of them, hardest worker on practice, hardest worker in the game, incredible energy in the game, in the practice. I never seen that in a player before. And of course, he won championship, he was MVP, he earned it, same like that. He earned all this, but nothing was given to him. It's hours and hours in the gym. And Antoine Walker was a talent, but didn't want to work hard. This is the difference between the two of them. I play in the same position, Antoine. I used to guard him on practice and play against him on practice. And of course, I go hard. And many times he just quit. He like, screw you, Bruno. I go. I have a game tomorrow. I don't want to practice. So he just walked out the gym a few times. So he didn't want to take. He didn't want to be competitive of all the time. On the hand, Paul Pierce, 24/7.
Wow.
Yeah, so this is the big difference between two of them.
Interesting. So you continue playing for the Cleveland Cavaliers and for the New York Knicks. And if I'm not mistaken, it was LeBron James's rookie season. Yeah, how was that going?
Yes, it was a LeBron rookie season. And you can see from day one, he will be the game changer. He was just oversized.
Powerful.
Powerful, huge, with 18, with the ball handling, and you can see from day one. And then again, Cleveland wasn't in a good position as a playoff team, so it was perfect fit for him to grow.
Yeah.
And years later, I guess, he done what he done. You know, but definitely one of the top players.
Okay, but you didn't stay too long with the Cleveland Cavaliers. You actually played for the New York Knicks. How was that experience?
Thing is, with Cleveland, at that year, I couldn't really stand not playing. I was doing everything and I didn't get a burn. And there was I really come to the wall, I need to change something. That episode with the Knicks was only for 10 days. And again, Isaiah was there, and all I asked, I was like, listen, I will come, no problem, but I want to play. Cannot guarantee you will put me in second rotation, 10 minutes per game, I don't ask for more, I will not stay. So I stayed there for 10 days contract and it didn't happen, and the team was many problems in the team. Lenny Wilkins was coach and I didn't play, and I was like, okay guys, I will not continue, I need to go play. And then same year I went to Maccabi Tel Aviv. It was the right choice. We won EuroLeague at that year. we won the EuroLeague, and I decided I cannot sit on the bench no more, no matter where it is. I decided to play.
Okay, well, after 6 years, your NBA career was over and you played basically all over the world. I would like to know, where did you enjoy yourself the most? What was the greatest experience playing?
It was Spain, for sure. It's a sports country, sports culture country, not only basketball, football, basketball, handball, volleyball, you name it, they are full gyms. So I spent in Spain on and off for 4 years, and I think the best overall experience with fan-wise, basketball-wise, country-wise, culture-wise, people-wise, I really had a great time there.
All right, well, let's get to the part and the questions that apparently no NBA player or former NBA player likes to answer. But hey, I would like to know your personal top five. And yeah, basically, after naming the player, tell us why he belongs in your top five ever.
NBA players or overall?
NBA players. I would say let's stick with NBA players.
Sure. Bill Russell.
Okay, why?
Those rings on his... He was missing fingers, I guess. He was missing fingers, how many rings he won. And for his era, I guess he was one of the dominant players and one of the great team players, and Boston won what he won. With him on team, so that's definitely him. Second one, it's Will Chamberlain, of course. For his era, he was one of the top big men.
Yeah,
he scored 100 points, whatever. Just dominant big man for a time. Definitely number two, number three, it's Larry Bird.
Yes.
He put the fun to the game. He put the assist. He put a joke to the game, I think. At the moment, he was revolutionary. Him and Magic that I play.
Yeah.
Okay, Magic is number four, the same. You remember those rivalry?
Yeah,
Boston, LA. Yeah. They put the basketball on a map worldwide,
I think,
even in front of the football from most of the countries, because of those rivalry, those two guys. So that's 3-4. And the number five, of course, MJ. I mean, it's hard to say. He's not. I could probably move him to number one.
Yes.
You know, but or other way around, all those guys. It's definitely definitely Michael. What he did. It's one of the rarest players. He's unstoppable. You know, as a player, then he showed defensively he can do it. He was just a perfect example of one of the top basketball players.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're missing LeBron James on your top five, and you're missing Kobe Bryant on your
During
top five.
During that time period, you had some
great
teammates, not
easy,
some players that I like, like Gary Trent, and one player that I especially like, AC Green, the Iron Man, the player with the most consecutive games in NBA history. And I remember when I watched NBA back then, for whatever reason, the streak ended, and you told me something about that that had something to do with you. So what was that all about?
Kobe in front of him, or maybe even Shaq. Try to squeeze on in the top five, but who are you gonna take out?
Yeah, it's difficult.
Yeah, who are you gonna take out of those top five? Larry Bird? I mean, Will Chamberlain, Bill Russell, who are you gonna take out to squeeze those guys in? Maybe you're gonna go top 10, maybe. It's easier.
Yeah.
You know?
Yes, of course, not easy. So many great players, but like, who was your personal nemesis? Like, the player you really hated to play against?
Karl Malone. He's just like a rock. That guy doesn't seem okay. Of course he's strong, but to play against him, you don't want to come even close to him, because it's just too fast, too strong. He will hurt you. You don't care, you know. So it's definitely one of the toughest guys I play against.
You told me a funny story yesterday. You said that if you hold the ball in front of Karl Malone's face, you're gonna lose a finger.
Coach is telling you better protect the ball or take it higher. If you put just in front of him, be ready to miss a finger or two, because when he snap you with the ball on top of a ball, you're gonna get a big bruise.
You know, as an NBA fan, you can already see that Karl Malone is strong, but hearing that from a huge guy like yourself, 7'3", unbelievable.
You can ask whoever played against him. In that era, I don't know, even Shaq, when playing against Shaq, he wasn't that strong. He was just pure muscle, pure wall. You know, Shaq is just like a bubble. And he need to hear some funny story about Shaq also. The thing is with Shaq, we used to have scouting reports, right? Every single player has go right, left, go right, do this, do that. With the Shaq, is only one sentence in the scouting report. Guess what it is? Do not piss him off.
What? That was the only sentence? In a scouting report?
One sentence. Everybody has hundreds. Then you have Shaquille O'Neal, points, rebounds, and one line. Do not piss big man off. Nothing else. Let him score 15-20. He will not hurt us. Kobe will hurt us. Rick Fox will hurt us. I don't know, Fisher will hurt us. Shaq, you know, he's a sleeping beast. But do not wake up this beast. Yeah, so that's the thing. When he gets pissed off, he breaks rims, breaks everybody. He's really, really unstoppable.
Unbelievable, just unbelievable. Bruno, you played with so many legends. Reggie Miller, Paul Pierce, Antoine Walker, Michael Finley. Just tell me, who was the most special player you ever played with? Like, who was the greatest teammate, the most special icon in your basketball career?
Let me try to squeeze two. Dirk later on become what he become, and I really admire his game because we become similar way of the game two was playing. But let's say Paul Pierce and Reggie Miller, those two, they really left marks on my career as a player, and they will leave marks on my career as a coach to do things they do to implement to other. I implement to myself, and I'll definitely implement to other kids.
Right.
So you just mentioned Dirk Nowitzki again. Did you see in his rookie season that he would be that kind of special player, that a potential, legend?
I see him because German mentality, working. He brings his assistant coach, Holger, I think. Yes, him. He come 2-3 times per year. Every time Dirk has problems, Holger come. And I used to practice with them individually, especially, you know, when he get a hard time, those two, they go in the gym. And I ask, can I come with you? He said, sure. So he was really his mentor for a long time. And I think if you ask Dirk, Holger helped him a lot in his career and helped him a lot in off seasons to get him ready, to get him to become what he become. It's definitely him. It's hard work. It's hard work, have to pay off, and of course you have to have support of coaching staff. They believe in you, what will happen in Dallas, and then you're all set. Then you have Dirk. Nowadays, you see.
I remember you told me yesterday that in your rookie season, your coach Don Nelson said something to Dirk that, probably every shooter would wish to hear. He said something like, we're going to lose anyway, so I want you to take as many shots as possible so we can work on your game. I mean, that, to a basketball player, got to be the greatest thing you can probably hear.
They give him unconditional credit, especially first year and second also, you know. Like, we're losing team, we're not gonna come to playoffs, so I wanna make something out of it. And you, the first one in line. Steve Nash, I want you every time you have a chance, pass the ball to Dirk. So for those 2 years, Don was really forcing them to make extra shot, to make tough shots. And in the beginning, Dirk wasn't shooting like this, he wasn't forcing shot, and he was benched many times because of this. And he asked me, Bruno, those guys are crazy, they want me to shoot 30 balls, I don't care how. I was like, if you have issues with this, I don't have problem with that. If the coach asked me to shoot silly shot, he's like, sure, I will do it, but this looked funny. And it was, looking a little awkward, and he wasn't feeling comfortable shooting, but then he built up. Confidence build up, and Dirk become what he become. And with one of the greatest point guards, which you asked me earlier, I would definitely put Steve Nash on that list. He made Dirk what Dirk become. Without Steve, I don't think Dirk would be reach the level.
Yeah, we had the conversation already. You said that Steve Nash is probably one of the best point guards to ever play the game. And I agree. I totally agree. I mean, to me, he's one of the most underrated players in NBA history because that guy won two MVP awards because he made his team better. And that is something that people underestimate. Your goal as a point guard is to make your team better. And he did that.
Exactly. Him. You asked me earlier, who's the best point guard? I didn't think too much. It's Steve Nash, point guard. Okay, Jason Kidd was also there. I don't know, many other guards.
Stockton.
Yeah, Stockton is also there. But I think Steve took criticism when team lose. He said, "I lose this game. I didn't get involved, Mike. I didn't get involved enough, Mike, Dirk, Ceballos, whatever. First, I look for myself first. So if you watch early in the stages, Steve, and he play first half, he don't score at all. First half, he only look how other players how to improve their games, and then later on, if needed to be done, he's one of the greatest scorers. Also, he pick up." He's scoring also when it's needed. But I think he was, for me, truly point guard at the time.
All right, so we're heading for the last question. So I would like to know, what current projects do you have? What are you doing right now? What are you looking for? So what's going to happen with you?
I just recently stopped playing. I stopped my 20 years of playing career. Enrolled in coaching school. Just finished my coaching school back in Croatia, so I will turn into coaching. So this is the next thing, a new phase in my life. I don't want to have any gaps in between, take rest and all this, it's not needed.
So you're going to dedicate your life to basketball, again in the gym?
It's again, I'm in the gym, but just on from different perspectives. So hopefully I can pass my experience to younger players.
Okay,
Okay, so what is your final goal? Like, where's the limit? You want to be a professional coach in terms of coaching in the NBA, or what is the plan?
I'm way far from it now. Same like when you start playing basketball. Nobody guarantees you will succeed. I know my path, I know my working habits.
During that time period, you had some great teammates, some players that I like Gary Trent, and one player that I especially liked, AC Green, the Iron Man, the player with the most consecutive games in NBA history. And I remember, guys, that was my interview with Bruno Sundov, and I gotta say, that guy is a very special person. I had the honor and the joy to spend 3 days with him at a youth basketball camp. That guy really feels not only the need, but the urge and the obligation to pass his knowledge of basketball to the kids, give back something to the community. This guy is very special, and overall, it was just a great experience. So I hope to see you at the next episode. Stay tuned.